Video two of the day. I'm a little biased on this, but I'm going to show like a two-part Torrey Krug play, mainly for defensemen. If you're a current defenseman, basically playing at the AA, AAA, junior, sort of an elite level, and you can't do two of the things that Torrey Krug does, it's going to be a hard time for you to really establish yourself as a top four, top two defenseman on your team. So what I'm going to talk about here is Torrey Krug's A, his puck retrieval here, and quickly recognizing one, two, forecheckers. One's going hard. This one's cutting behind the net, taking away the D2D pass. So what does he do? He's got to find another option. Quickly goes, makes a tape-to-tape pass, and they're up and out of the zone. Second thing here, you'll notice where Torrey Krug is in the offensive zone. He's not afraid to get below that hash mark and play in the offensive zone and help out and chip in offensively. Does a good job getting the puck, shedding off a defender, making a pass, getting some sort of thing going. And where does he go? Back out of the zone. Okay, a little biased because Torrey Krug is my favorite defenseman, probably the only defenseman I really like, but just wanted to show that. And the second thing we're going to talk about is zone entry for forwards. And what do you see here from the St. Louis Blues? All right. It'll come to a point because he has to stay on sides right here. One, two, three. What is this? Straight line, right? Well, Oscar Sundquist doesn't recognize that because Joel Edmondson, no, he's not even on the team anymore. Whoever this is on number six in the Blues is driving to the net. That's what he was doing here. He wasn't really looking for a pass. But they go in a straight line, and they can't really get much going or set up much in the offensive zone. So it ends up being like kind of like a broken zone entry. Luckily, they get something from it. But here is never a good way to enter the zone in a straight line, right? Maybe Oscar Sundquist comes this way a little bit, delays, goes into the zone. This guy cuts behind the guy driving to the net, opens up this pass. Once that space opens, bam. Second thing we're going to talk about is the Sharks' first goal. And that is, so here you got the winger, they win the puck, they win the faceoff, the winger gets the puck, delays a little bit, notices he can't go up this way, pushes the puck down low for a cycle. Couture does a good job keeping the puck in front of him, pushes it to the D. And now where did that guy go who made that initial pass? Bam, right to the front. Shot, scores. Second thing we're going to focus on here is what does Brent Burns do when he gets the puck? Shoots it right away. Doesn't collect it, doesn't delay, doesn't hold on to the puck too long. It's literally that puck is coming off the boards and he's getting ready for a shot automatically. Next thing we'll talk about is actually a shorthanded goal for the Blues, I think it was. And this is something that I just don't get why forwards do. And, you know, it's almost like refreshing to see NHL players doing it because my high school players do it. And that's just forcing pucks into areas they don't need to force the puck, right? Like, why are we trying to throw this puck through this way, through the middle of the ice? You got one, two, three blue players. They try and force a puck through the middle. Nothing comes from it. And we get an ad. Bam, 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 bam. I'm talking in a second. Hold on. Nothing ends up coming from that pass. They go up the other way. Falk comes out of the box. Unreal shot by Falk through the defenseman's legs. And they score. But, it all comes from just forcing this pass when you don't need to force the pass. Like, what are his other options? I don't know. Go back up to the D and make it like a safety valve instead of throwing pucks through the middle of the ice. Like, where was this even going? Was that going to 62? Just a horrible pass. Something you shouldn't do if you're forward on that. Especially if you want to play consistent power play minutes. You shouldn't just be forcing passes through the middle of the ice for no reason. Next, we're going to talk about the Blues' second goal. So here you'll notice they go around the net and these two players get a little bit confused of what they're doing. So he picked up the guy coming through the middle, or the guy coming through the middle set a pick. He couldn't get to his D quick enough. Gives him time and space to shoot, tip in, and goal. I'm not saying that's the reason why they scored, but, you know, that's just the glaring thing that you see is just miscommunication between Hurdle and the other Sharks forward, because now look how much time and space Colton Parayko has to shoot. We're not lifting sticks as defensemen on San Jose. It doesn't surprise me. You got Garrett Carlson out there, one of the laziest defensemen in the league. Shot and tipped in score. We'll be ripping into Eric Carlson, actually, in a few seconds here. Not right now, but coming up. Here's something. Just a 50-50 on the wall. Jordan Kyrou, whoever this kid is, add him to your fantasy team if you play fantasy hockey. This kid is unreal. He probably had about 7 shots on net and played like 15 minutes last night and had multiple scoring opportunities. Just something you can't do if you're the San Jose Sharks is 2 players get beat by 1. And luckily, nothing comes from it, but a good scoring opportunity comes from it. So you'll notice, slow down again. You'll notice what Brent Burns does. He does the good old, my stick is a sword, and waves it around. Just horrible. And now we rip into Eric Carlson, because this guy's game has deteriorated greatly in the last, 4 years. Like, I don't think he knows how to skate backwards. He can, or he's capable of skating backwards anymore. Jordan Kyrou, again, you know, they lose the puck here. The Sharks, Jordan Kyrou again, ends up picking off the pass and just blows by Eric Carlson. Ends up blowing by him. I think they end up scoring not here, but right there. But we're going to talk about real quickly what Jordan Kyrou does and what Eric Carlson does, okay? So, 1, Eric Carlson, 1, 2, 3 crossovers, beat, flat-footed, basically. Gone, non-existent. What does Jordan Kyrou do? Watch. Jordan Kyrou recognizes that Eric Carlson doesn't have much speed. He's crossing over with the puck, getting speed, gaining speed with the puck. Just chips it to a spot and goes after the puck because he knows he can beat Eric Carlson with his speed. Gets it to a spot, gets an opportunity, and they end up scoring from it. Second to last thing we'll go into is the St. Louis Blues breakout that goes and leads to and end up leading to a goal. Go D to D, good rim, good puck retrieval here by the forward. Push it to the center flying. Here you go, zone entry. Ends up scoring. You'll notice who scores. It's not Ryan O'Reilly or David Perron. It's Justin Falk, the defenseman, coming through the middle of the ice, stick on the ice, and just right place, right time. And the last one, St. Louis's 5th and dagger goal by none other than Jordan Kyrou. This kid had a day. We're going to get an ad in 4 seconds here, so be aware. What I do want to recognize here is change. Puck comes out. Krug doesn't look to go right back into the zone with it and dump the puck in for no fucking reason. He looks to go, okay, they're changing. I noticed that we have numbers. They don't have numbers. Let's go D to D. Let's get into the zone quickly. Kyrou gets there. He's swinging through the middle. Supports Parayko. And we get an ad. Hold on. 3, 2, 1... Supports Parayko behind the puck, gets the pass, shot, score. All because of just a quick D-to-D in the neutral zone, quick up, and you get into the zone with speed. You get the Sharks on a change, and they end up scoring. And that is all. Hope you guys enjoy. See you later.